Namaste. When we hear the term Inquisition, we always associate it with the Catholic Church. Catholic Church has an elaborate doctrine, a theology, a worldview. And whatever goes contrary to this particular theology, this particular worldview, those heresies be persecuted. The people who adhere to these heresies, they would be destroyed. Either they would be put into jail or they would be killed. Now, in the case of Inquisition, what you have is an elaborate state, a power structure that feels threatened because of certain heresies to its worldview. Because the worldview is the basis for its power structure. So the Catholic theology is a bundle of Christian belief and Aristotelian philosophy. Suppose there is a scientific discovery that goes against the Aristotelian philosophy or the Catholic theology, then that particular scientific discovery would be crushed. Simply stated, the science should be the handmaiden of theology. This is the basis of Inquisition against scientists that was launched by the Catholic Church. Today, the Catholic Church does not indulge itself in Inquisition, not because it does not want to, but because it doesn't have the power. The same is true for most of the mimetic clones of such exclusivist, such monopolistic religions. This also includes Marxism. When Marxism had power, state power, what was its encounter with science? Its encounter with science was in the nature of Inquisition. Marxist state, whether it is Soviet Union or China, they ran an Inquisition far more cruel, far more efficient than the Catholic Church. What the Catholic Church could not achieve in centuries of Inquisition, the Marxists achieved in decades. Such was the efficiency of Marxist Inquisition. Whenever we talk about Marxist Inquisition, the Marxists today, they always say that it is not because of Marxism, it is because of certain individuals. The individuals are at fault. Stalin was at fault. Particularly Stalin was at fault. That is what they would say. But in this lecture, we will see how Marxism from the beginning has always wanted science to be the handmaiden of ideology, of Marxist dogma. It starts right from Karl Marx himself. Just see this particular quote of Karl Marx. It was made in 1844. Natural sciences will in time incorporate into itself the science of man, just as the science of man will incorporate into itself natural science, that there will be one science. This is a very interesting quotation, because by one science, what Marx means is Marxism. Marx and Engels, they have formed something called Marxism, in which the mystic doctrine was a process called dialectical materialism and historical materialism. Now this dialectics, this is the process that has to be discovered by the sciences and all branches of science. If some scientist says that it is not so, then that scientist would become heretic. Long before Marxism attained state power, Marxism has started doing this. That is, making science a handmaiden of ideology. In 1859, Charles Darwin published his Origin of Species. 1861, Karl Marx was writing about Darwin's book. This is what he said. Darwin's work is most important and suits my purpose in that it provides a basis in natural science for the historical class struggle. Note these words very carefully. Darwin's work is important not because it is factual. Darwin's work is important not because it uncovers an important process in the natural world, namely natural selection. Darwin's work is important because it suits my purpose, that it provides a basis in natural science for the historical class struggle. Now, this was in 1861. Now what happens? After some more reading, very next year, Karl Marx was having doubts. So now in 1862, Karl Marx writes about Darwin. It is remarkable how Darwin rediscovers among the beasts and plants the society of England with its division of labor, competition, opening up of new markets, inventions, and Malthusian struggle for existence. And he says it's amusing. The most interesting thing comes in 1866. Here, Karl Marx completely rejects Darwin. And he says, there is another one natural scientist, more of a philosopher, speculative philosopher than a natural scientist. But for Karl Marx, he was a better person than Darwin. He says, P. Tremox, I may be wrong with the pronunciation, it's French, originate transformations is more important. It's very significant advance over Darwin, he says. And remember, the very same letter, he tells that this particular person, Tremox, had spent a long time in Africa, and he shows that the common Negro type is only a degeneration of a far higher one. Here you see something very interesting. You see that here, right in from the writings of Karl Marx, you see that Karl Marx was also a racist. He was thinking in terms of the European farmers being a far higher one and the black man as a kind of a degeneration from that far higher one. So here what you see is, leave that racism aside, what you see here from 1861 to 1866, in all these correspondence, what you see is this, that Karl Marx values, or he throws away a particular scientific discovery, not for the value of truth in it, but for its ideological value. It suits my ideology, I will take it. If it doesn't suit my ideology, I will throw it away. Right. As an ideologue, as a person who was thinking and writing the book or formulating an ism, this is a defect. This is a deficiency in Marxism. We can say that. But what happens when you get power? When such an ideology gets state power, then what happens? We will see how the Marxists, after Karl Marx, continued this particular legacy. In 1908, Vladimir Ilyich Lenin was an exile in Europe from Russia. He was having a lot of spare time. At that time, he wrote a book, Materialism and Embryo Criticism. Not exactly a booklet. But a very important work, because this booklet, in which Lenin very carefully studied the developments in new physics within the framework of Marxism, within the framework of dialectical materialism, this booklet would decide later the lives and deaths of many physicists. So in this book, Lenin was harsh on almost all important physicists and philosophers of physics of his time. Perry Duhem was a physicist and a philosopher of science. So in his book, The Aim and Structure of Physical Theory, he considers the laws of physics as neither true nor false, but approximate, because they are symbolic picturing of reality in a more or less precise, more or less detailed manner. Lenin got very angry. He said that this statement contains the beginning of falsity. Now, remember, a person like Louis de Broglie, and students of physics will know Louis de Broglie as the man associated with the famous particle wavelength relating equation. He considered Pierre Duhem's work as a beautiful and a great work where physics of today can still find numerous topics worthy of reflection and study. But for Lenin, this is a statement that contains the beginning of the falsity. And it's all obscurantism, out and out reaction. To regard atoms and molecules, electrons, etc., as an approximately true reflection in our mind of the objectively real movement of matter is equivalent to believing in an elephant upon which the world rests. These are the words of Lenin. Then he says, and here it's very interesting, the philosophy of the scientist Marx is to science what the kiss of Christian Judas was to Christ. Note the overt religious imagery that Lenin gives. The philosophy of the scientist Marx, that is Ernest Marx he is talking about, the philosophy of the scientist Marx is to science what the kiss of the Christian Judas was to Christ. Marx likewise betrays science into the hands of fadism by virtually deserting to the camp of philosophical idealism. Marx's renunciation of natural scientific materialism is a reactionary phenomenon in every respect. Now note his condemnation of Ernst Marx. Any student of history of physics would know what is the place you should give for Ernst Marx. And here, this is what Lenin writes. And it is in 1908. 1917 hasn't yet come. The power hasn't yet come. But this is how they evaluate scientists. This is how they evaluate scientific theories on the framework of their ideology. And the 1905 to 1910, this particular period was very, very creative period in the history of physics. Physics was undergoing a metamorphosis, a transformation. From the Newtonian physics, we are moving on to the, what is called the new physics. No, it is a flowering of creativity. Just the creativity was bursting forth. But for Lenin, he sees this period as a temporary deflection, a transitory period of sickness in the history of science, an ailment of growth. That is how he sees it. The very flowering of new physics for Lenin is a transitory period of sickness. And then he makes this very important statement. He says, one school, he means the physicists, one school of natural scientists in one branch of natural science has slid into the reactionary philosophy, being unable to rise directly and at once from metaphysical materialism to dialectical materialism. This step is being made and will be made by modern physics, but it is making for the only true method and only true philosophy of natural science, not directly, but by zigzags, not consciously, but instinctively, not clearly perceiving its final goal, but drawing closer to it, groping hesitatingly, and sometimes even with its back turned to it. So here he actually, what he does is, he puts the position, the power of party ideologue over that of the philosophy of science. So a natural scientist, what he discovers, what he ought to discover, will be decided by the ideological commissar of right now Marxist philosophy. When they capture the power, the commissar of the party, the commissar of the party will decide what you should discover and whether what you have discovered should be published or not, whether what you have discovered would send you to the gulag. So in 1930, just 4 years from 1917, when the Soviets would capture the power, 1913, Lenin wrote, the Marxist doctrine is omnipotent because it is true. Not always the language. The only true philosophy. The only true method. It is omnipotent because it is true. It is almost a religious fundamentalism. But Marxists were able to win the hearts of intellectuals who supported Marxism, telling that they were embracing a secular scientific way of looking at reality. Then they captured power. When they were capturing power, almost at the same time, the Einstein's theory of relativity was very much that well established. These people were struggling with Einstein's philosophy, Einstein's theory of relativity and its philosophical implication. Alexander Vishnevich, a very important historian of science, he says about this particular phase in Marxist science. Right now, the Marxists have captured power. So Marxist philosophers were the most active, the most inconsistent interpreters of Einstein's theory. Much of their uncertainty stemmed from Lenin's warning that modern revolution in physics was not only a great leap in man's incessant effort to unblock the mysteries of nature, but also an enticing invitation to physical idealism. As defined by Lenin, physical idealism included all philosophical orientations in modern physics that refused to view matter as the primary substratum of physical reality, emphasized the subjective origins of scientific knowledge, and challenged the effectiveness of causality as the basic explanatory principle in science. Now, the problem here, what Vishnevich actually says is this. Marxism wants science to become more and more materialistic, in very simple words. But Einstein's theory of relativity was creating a problem. As Einstein himself said, for us believing physics, the space and time are illusions and those kind of things when he was talking about. These actually are putting a question mark. And quantum mechanics. When we had quantum mechanics, and particularly the Copenhagen interpretation of quantum mechanics, it created a real serious problem for Marxist commissars. So they were very angry. They said that this is entirely nothing but bourgeois science and that it should be completely rejected. There were a group of brilliant Soviet physicists, Lev Landau, George Gamow, Ivanov, and Matvey Bronstein. These people, they called themselves musketeers. They created a small band of physicists. They even created a jazz group. These people were batting for quantum mechanics. The results were terrible. Gamow was he escaped death by emigrating. So he ended up in the University of Colorado. Ivanenko was briefly arrested. Bronstein was not lucky. In 1937, he was shot dead. Lev Landau had to spend 1 year in prison before being arrested. Because now, by 1924, Lenin had died and Stalin had to go over. Now, the physics were really fearing the kind of inquisition they were going to face. In fact, the Soviet education minister wrote a letter to his principal secretary, pointing out that the way the physics is being taught, it is undermining dialectical materialism. Physics is taught in many educational establishments without any regard to dialectical materialism. Instead of decisively unmasking the trends which are inimical to Marxism and Leninism, some of our scientists frequently adopt idealist positions which are making their way into higher educational establishments through physics. Essentially, the letter is long. They were talking about how this dialectical materialism is there destroying the idealist bourgeois decadence, but unfortunately the physics teachers are betraying this dialectical materialist science by siding with bourgeois science, etc. And they were ready in 1949 to even go for a resolution in the party to condemn quantum physics and everything. This was the draft of 1949 party, this thing, that fortunately it didn't came into an action. The modern achievements of physics do not receive consistent exposition on the basis of dialectical materialism in Soviet physics textbooks. The role of Russian and Soviet scientists in the development of physics is treated in completely inadequate way in textbooks. The books abound in the names of capitalist scientists. So with this kind of things, they were trying to ban teaching theory of relativity. In fact, the theory of relativity came under very strong attacks from a particular Marxist theoretician called Timiryazev. So Timiryazev said that Einstein's theories are at times scaled by the world press, but they are falling far below the norm and a long way from adequate empirical verification. And this particular article was written when Lenin was alive, and Lenin praised this article. He said that in this article, there is a hope that we will create an alliance with modern natural scientists in fighting against the idealist trends and all these kind of things. But if you look at the history of Soviet Union, you will find one very interesting thing. Suddenly, this inquisition against the Soviet physics, it stopped. Why this inquisition against Soviet physics stopped? It's because of Stalin. It's a very interesting thing, because Stalin stopped the inquisition when his killer friend, comrade, Beria, was told by Khrushchev, who was a very great physicist, Soviet physicist. So these people wanted to create the hydrogen bomb. They were fighting with the, there was the Cold War in order, and there is this arms race. Soviet Union was competing with the United States, and United States had successfully not only tested atom bomb, but they have even dropped an atom bomb. And they also wanted to produce atom bombs. Now, if you want to produce atom bombs, you have to teach new physics. So Beria called Khrushchev and he asked, is it true that we have to teach quantum mechanics and Einstein's theory of relativity if we need to have bombs? And Khrushchev said, yes, if you don't teach relativity and quantum mechanics, you can forget atom bomb. So now Beria went and told this to Stalin. And Stalin said, and these have become, these lines have become classical lines. Stalin said, okay, allow them to teach, allow them to make the bomb. Once they make the bomb, we can shoot them later. So with these words, he allowed the physicists to make the atom bomb. What would have been the fate of physics had Stalin lived longer and had thought that their usefulness was over, we don't know. Fortunate for physics, Stalin died and they escaped. Lev Landau was later hailed as a great hero by Soviet Union, and all the things happened. But the biologists were not that lucky as the physicists. In the case of biology, you see, at that time, Mendel's laws of genetics have been discovered. And as you know, Gregor Mendel, who discovered these laws of genetics, he was an Austrian monk, a boat in a monastery. And he was doing some experiments on pea plants. And he discovered that these laws in a very statistical manner. Unfortunately, they didn't come to light immediately. But later, its importance was discovered. And the geneticists and the evolutionists, they studied this very clearly. No evolutionist opposed Mendel's genetics laws. The result was that by 1940s, we were having something called neo-Darwinism, or the synthesis of Mendelian genetics with Darwinian natural selection. And it is one of the very wonderful, successful stories of science. Now, in the case of Marxists, what happened was, they saw that the acquired characters was in, somehow they got this idea that the inheritance of acquired characters was in tune with the dialectical materialism, and that Mendelian genetics was against dialectical materialism. So Mendelian genetics was labeled as bourgeois science. It was labeled as a decadent bourgeois science, and it was associated with the racism, etc., etc. The same way, acquired characters, inheritance of acquired characters was considered as a kind of the real science, and anyone who advocated the inheritance of acquired characters was hailed as a great hero. And there were people who were always ready to exploit this particular type of hype in the establishment. So one such person was Lysenko. Lysenko was just an ordinary farmer who was basically involved in crossbreeding and all those kind of things. And he had a mentor. And this mentor was a kind of a strong Marxist. And his name was Michurin. Michurin too was a plant breeder. But he was totally unaware of Mendelian laws. And he considered Mendelian laws and doctrines of as having no significance for later. They will definitely be proved wrong and they would be corrected by others. That was his idea. There were wonderful genetists in Soviet Union. Like, for example, the best example is Nikolai Vavilov. Nikolai Vavilov was a fantastic scientist. He was a genetist. And he was also collecting a large variety of seeds. And he was trying to create a seed bank and all that. And when he saw that these people were essentially peddling nothing but nonsense, he tried to tell them that they were wrong. But Lysenko and Michurin were the Soviet success stories. They were projected as Soviet success stories. Hajje Muller, who was a Nobel laureate at that time, this is something important that we should remember. These famous intellectuals of the West at that time, they were all enamored by Marxism. They saw Soviet Union as a very great new human experiment, a kind of a move towards utopia, and they used to compete with each other to go to Soviet Union and live there and work for this great new golden utopia that is coming up. So one such person who went there was Hajje Muller, who was a Nobel laureate. He was a genetist. And he writes what was the condition there. And he was shocked once he went there and discovered what really was his utopia inside. In 1933 or thereabouts, genetics, there are certain names, Russian names, were all on separate occasions banished to Siberia and to a labor camp in European Arctic. In 1936, the communist genetist Agol was done away with following rumors that he had been convicted of Menshevik idealism in genetics. By Menshevik idealism, they mean the genes theory. So anyone who accepted the genes theory, even if they were communists, but because they were genetists, they were scientists, they have to accept this truth of genes. If they accepted it, they would be banished. So it is impossible to learn the real causes of the deaths of distinguished genetists. He gives a few names. Certain is, however, that from 1936 on, Soviet genetists of all ranks lived in a life of fear and terror. Most of them who were not imprisoned, banished or executed were forced to enter other lines of work. The great majority of those who were allowed to remain in their laboratories were obliged to redirect their researches in such a way as to make it appear that they were trying to prove the correctness of the officially approved anti-scientific views. Note this very clearly. The great majority of those who were allowed to remain in the laboratories were obliged to redirect their researchers in such a way as to make it appear that they were trying to prove the correctness of officially approved anti-scientific views. The person who stood against this was Vavilov. So what happened to Vavilov? Vavilov was arrested on 6th August 1940. He was on an expedition to Ukraine. Then he was sentenced to death in July 1941. It would have been a far merciful thing, but unfortunately, in 1942, his sentence was commuted to 20 years of life imprisonment. 1943, because of starvation and diseases, he died in prison. So this is what happened to a scientist who stood for his science in Soviet Union. Perhaps Vavilov is today more relevant than Galileo, in the sense today we see again the Marxists always wearing the mask of a scientific theory, going around capturing institutions. The case of India, when Yashpal, this famous scientist, with the help of satellite images, talked about the Saraswati River. Irfan Habib, the Marxist historian in India, he wrote a denouncement. Why the denouncement? Not in scientific lines, but because this would be against the stand taken by the Politburo. The same way you can say D.N. Jha, Romila Thapa, all these people, they are the Lysenkos of Indian history. All these people, they always talk about the party line, like Dilip Chakraborty told very nicely that these people invented feudalism in India. Well, factually, empirically, there was no feudalism. It was similar to, in fact, it was more harmful than claiming that there were missiles and aeroplanes in ancient times. This was no different. But these kind of things were done in India because of the same mentality that created the Marxist Inquisition in Soviet Union. The story doesn't end there. If you have with you a copy of A Brief History of Time by Stephen Hawking, go through it. There are two interesting things that Hawking says. One is his meeting with the Pope. The Pope says, okay, you scientists can study about the Big Bang. Up to Big Bang, it's okay. But you don't go before Big Bang because that belongs to God. You shouldn't do it. And Stephen Hawking writes that I didn't tell him about my theory that actually doesn't care about Big Bang and just makes it a part of a larger cycle and all those kind of things. But if I have told him, perhaps I just remember what happened to Galileo. Just he leaves that there. Then if you go through the book again, you will find another one thing. He wanted to work with a particular Soviet physicist on his theory of black holes and cosmology. But that physicist was not allowed to work with, that Soviet physicist was not allowed to work with Stephen Hawking because the commissars, the Soviet party people, communist party people, they thought that this would go against the dialectical materialism. So this tendency has been there. The Inquisition perhaps was not there. There was some amount of leniency. They gave some room for everything. They have to make ideological adjustments. For example, if you are writing, you can see that in 1980s, and we used to have a lot of this popular science books from Soviet Union. And in these popular science books, what you will find is a very interesting thing. Everything will be prepared with the quotations from Marx and Lenin or Engels. And even if it is a book on human anatomy, you would have to have a quotation from Lenin. So the physicists were ready to do that. They said, okay, fine. We'll give devil its due. We'll put Lenin's quote, and then we will write what we want to write. Like Levlando has written a very beautiful book on popular science book on general theory of relativity, which was published by Mir Publishers, and it contains a quotation by Lenin. And then it would be allowed. So that kind of sanitizing things were allowed. And but note one thing. Just one dictator like Stalin, just one dictator like Mao, they can come back, they can again reverse the entire clock. The problem is the theory. The theory is a closed theory. Just see the difference with Marxism and with Darwinism. In the case of Darwinism, you have a new discovery called Mendelian genetics. Now, Mendelian genetics is something that talks about a species continuing its similarity. And evolution is something that talks about changes. And evolutionists could have said, okay, this mental was a Christian Catholic abort. So let us say that it is all whole Christian conspiracy against science. Let us suppress Mendelian genetics. They didn't do that. They accepted Mendelian genetics. They went through it. They did more experiments and they synthesized with the Darwinian evolution. And now we have this neo-Darwinian evolution or the synthesis, new school of Darwinian evolution. So this is how science operates. Science operates as an open system. In the case of Marxism, Marxism is a closed system. You have only dialectical materialism. There is only one movement, that is the materialist dialectical movement in matter. You cannot go for any other movement. For example, today if you see, there are a lot of discussions in modern physics. They talk about consciousness being an emergent property, also consciousness being the very substratum of everything. There are schools that identify themselves with this particular way or that particular way. There is no inquisition. Everybody is talking about empirical proof. Based on the empirical proof, they will advance their theories. But in the case of Marxism, any discovery that you make, that would be subjected to ideological inquisition. And only if it passes the test, only if it is not a heresy, it would be allowed. Now, the same thing is being taken to our curriculum. We take our science textbooks. Why our science textbooks are not very impressive? The reason is because we are following the Soviet system. For example, in a case of 10th standard textbooks in Tamil Nadu, published in 2019. In fact, it has been published, and even if you look at the earlier versions, you can see that almost the same thing. You will find that the acquired characters, the inheritance of acquired characters, which has been proved wrong, is being taught. Why a giraffe is having a long neck? It is because the giraffe was trying to again and again eat leaves from higher and higher branches, and because of that, the neck elongated. So this is inheritance of acquired characters. This is absolutely wrong, but this is being taught today, even today, to children in Tamil Nadu. This is because we don't have the guts to tell that a theory supported by Marxism is a wrong scientific theory. In fact, what we have to do right now is create exhibitions of Marxist inquisition in Soviet Union, in China, how the physicists, how the biologists were treated, how they withstood this inquisition for the sake of science. They are the real heroes of science, not D.D. Goswami, not Romila Thapar, not Irfan Habib. All these people are charlatans, including D.D. Goswami. Go through his book, D.D. Goswami's book, you will find a very interesting thing in his ancient history of India. Usually, you know that Marxists have a very nuanced look at Buddhism. They would appreciate Buddhism as very materialistic and as very revolutionary and all that kind of thing, whereas so-called Brahminical religion is very oppressive and very unscientific, very idealistic and all these kind of things. But if you look at this particular book on ancient Indian history, when he is discussing the Nalanda, Ajanta, he says, this Ajanta cave paintings, they don't depict the ordinary life of people. And then he says, despite the fact that these Buddhist monks were living on the surplus of these ordinary people, like cart pullers or merchants, they were not depicting all these. They were only depicting the celestial nymphs, and they were depicting Buddhas and Bodhisattvas, but they were not depicting this ordinary life. They don't depict the real social reality. And it was a very staunch criticism of Buddhist thought. Note the year of publication. Just go and note the year of publication there. You will find that it coincides with cultural revolution, the so-called cultural revolution that was happening in Maoist China. In Maoist China, in the name of cultural revolution, scores of Buddhist monasteries were getting destroyed, Buddhist artworks were getting destroyed, the libraries were getting burned, Buddha statues were getting public decapitation. Yes, that was what happening to the Buddha statues in Maoist China. Then this guy was writing this. In a way, this is a kind of reverse engineered compliment to what Mao was doing in China, in the name of cultural revolution, to Buddhist monasteries. So this is how historiography has been constructed in India. Fortunately, in India, these people still could not have their hands on science in research institutions. That was one famous cellular biologist, a brilliant cellular biologist, Pushpa Bhargava. He created an exhibition called Methodology of Science Exhibition, MOSE, M-O-S-E, and it was launched during emergency, interestingly, when India was really slipping into an authoritarian rule. And in this, if you look at the exhibits, and I have told about this in my many lectures, earlier lectures also, if you look at this Method of Science exhibition, you will find that there was no panels given for Charles Darwin. Charles Darwin's face was not depicted, or even the word natural selection was not there, if my memory serves right. But there were two separate panels, one for Das Kapital and Karl Marx, with a mugshot of Marx and mugshot of Lenin. There was another one panel for Lenin, with Lenin there. The poster, your Soviet Union propaganda poster, was put in the place of Lenin. And then they said that was scientific planning. It was hailed for scientific planning. Marx was hailed for scientific study of society. And this was in Method of Science experiment, Method of Science exhibition. The science exhibition panels, they were not discussing Karl Popper's falsification or Thomas Hearn's paradigms, nothing like that. They were telling that the young impressionable minds, they were telling, okay, Karl Marx, Lenin, they were the pioneers of a kind of scientific study of the society. So this is nothing but using philosophy of science with government funding for Marxist propaganda. This was what some scientists were indulging in India also. But in the case of our history departments, the entire stranglehold of Marxism is no way different from the stranglehold that Marxists had in natural sciences in Soviet Union. So as I said, Romila Thapa, Irfan Habib, Arash Sharma, D.N. Jha, they were all basically lesson course of Indian history. And that is why it is also a lesson, that is also a lesson for us. What is that lesson? We cannot make science handmaiden of any ideology, however great that ideology may be, however subtle that philosophy may be. We cannot make it a handmaiden of this ideology. Fortunately, in India, that is not going to happen, mainly because India, you have 6 darshans. So each one is a grand worldview. Each one provides you a beautiful window to look into reality. So you are not shut with one particular, you are not fixated with one particular framework. You can easily move between these windows. In the case of India, you are not limited to any closed framework, any closed worldview. And there is no vested interest. There are no power structures built over these darshanas. These darshanas are for the seeker. They are not for peddlers or seekers of power. They are for the seekers of truth. So this aspect should be there in our mind, that for science to be efficient, for science to be free of inquisition, you need to have epistemological pluralism. And that is something that is available in India. There is a unique nature of Indian history and Indian heritage, Indian philosophy. We have to take that into consideration when we talk about preventing the inquisitions. Today we are living in troubled times. There is a huge set of forces which project themselves as democratic, while at the same time they are the forces that bat for authoritarianism. They are the forces that bat for Maoist China, they bat for Stalinist worldviews. Even today, there are parties which hold the portrait of Stalin in their party offices. They are proud to name their sons Stalin. We even have a CM candidate who has named Stalin. Stalin was a mass murderer. He was a criminal against humanity. But here are people who are who are happy to name their children Stalin? Think about it. If such people, they get power, what kind of researchers they would allow? If tomorrow a research comes out that goes against their pet theories, what they would do? What Irfan Habib did when Yashpal published his work on Saraswati, the kind of hatred they have for every discovery that goes against their pet organ invasion theory, just think about it. That is why we have to understand what Marxist Inquisition is, so that it will not happen again in the history of humanity. Thank you.